Thank you to the organisers for inviting me here. It's my first time in Bangalore and I'm having a very nice time. Thank you. So today I'm going to be talking on this topic, observing Bohmian momentum disturbance in double-slit which-way measurements, which probably doesn't make a lot of sense just from the title, but we'll see how it makes sense as we go along. So this is not... So observing means this really is an experiment. And so there are several collaborators. So the experiment was actually done in the University of Science and Technology, China, in Hefei. And so several of the authors from there. Another of my co-authors is actually will be talking later, Yaron Kadem, from the Department of Physics in Stockholm University. And I'm from Griffiths University, which is here in Brisbane, Australia, in the Centre for Quantum Dynamics. So, so I put my name in bold because I have a big ego, but I also put Ya Chao's name in bold because she was the PhD student who actually did the experiment and the data analysis, and so yes, so she definitely deserves to be highlighted. Okay, so this is what I'm going to cover. So I'm going to begin by saying a little bit about Bohmian mechanics. So luckily yesterday a number of people talked about it, so I'll just be able to go through this very briefly, but I thought it might help to put my own perspective on it. Then I'm going to talk about this which-way or Velkovec double-slit questions, controversies regarding momentum. I'll explain the history behind that. And then I'll talk about how we can put those two things together and come up with something interesting to see. Okay, so yeah, why Bohmian mechanics? Well, because of the problems with quantum theory. So it's not just me who thinks that there are problems with quantum theory. You see, hardcoregamer.com says quantum theory has a lot of problems. I think he was probably talking about this rather than the quantum theory we know. But nevertheless, it is true. Okay, and so as I see it, there are basically two problems. So one is a problem with the formalism in the sense that the formalism of quantum theory is disconnected from the everyday world. It's just not obvious how to connect it. For example, the quantum state lives in a very large dimensional Hilbert space. It doesn't live in the real world. And the second problem is, regardless of the formalism, just a problem with the phenomenon, of quantum phenomena, and that most distinctly in Bell's theorem, which is that it's not possible to reproduce quantum predictions by any physical theory that works by the familiar laws of cause and effect in a local way. Okay, so of course there have been many solutions proposed to these problems, and one solution is non-local hidden variables, of which Bohmian mechanics or the de Broglie-Bohm interpretation is the most famous. Rightly so. So very quickly to go through it. So in this interpretation, we think of, so I'm going to consider the simple case of just non-relativistic scalar particles. So then the quantum state is a wave function, which we actually think of as being a real wave. It doesn't exist in the three-dimensional world. It lives in configuration space, but nevertheless, it's a real thing sitting there. And it obeys the time-dependent Schrodinger equation with this Hamiltonian, so potential terms and some kinetic energy terms. Okay, but in addition to this real wave in configuration space, there is a single point in configuration space, a single real configuration, which I'll call X, which again, what's special about this, if we want to be ultimately say, how that relates to our experiences in the three-dimensional world is we have to say that this is the thing on which mind supervenes. Okay, not the wave function, but rather this real single configuration which represents the positions of all the particles. And of course, this single real configuration is famously piloted, to use de Broglie's term, by the wave function, by an equation like this. Okay, and there's just a picture of some Bohmian trajectories in this famous double-slit example, which will keep coming up. Okay, so that's as a solution, as I said, but of course this solution raises its own questions. In particular, you could ask, why believe in this particular interpretation? Because there is a problem of non-uniqueness. So they're experientially adequate hidden variables. In other words, theories that account for our experience of the world can be formulated in all sorts of ways, not just by the positions of the particles. And so it was Bell in 1984 who talked about this, introduced this very general type of theory. But in general, these have to be stochastic theories, okay? So you might not like stochasticity. But even if you do restrict to X and you restrict to deterministic theories, then we still have non-uniqueness in the sense that this velocity law that we can choose here, there are infinitely many possible velocity laws that we could choose and still give the same statistics as quantum mechanics, okay? So predict the same predictions that quantum mechanics does. So in other words, the way that works is infinitely many possible velocity laws where this equivariance equation is satisfied, which means that the probability distributions for this hidden variables will remain equal to the quantum probability distribution. Okay, so why would we believe in this particular hidden variable and why would we believe in its particular dynamics? My answer, anyway, the best answer that I can give. Let's say we like determinism over stochasticity. So in that case, we know that we're going to have to choose a hidden variable with a continuous spectrum, okay? Because if it has a discrete spectrum, the only way it can change is by jumping, and jumps have to be stochastic. So it has to be something with correspond to an observable with a continuous spectrum, like position or momentum. So let's consider position, for example. We can define, so this is a suggestion of mine I made back in 2007, that if we've chosen position, okay, and if we define the velocity law in this way in terms of weak and strong measurements, then we get the standard Bohmian mechanical expression for the velocity. Okay, so we heard also yesterday a few talks talking about weak measurements, so I'm not going to go through the details of that unless somebody asks and I can talk about it later. So the idea is to make, of course, that in classical physics, the way we would measure velocity would just be to measure the position at one time and then measure the position at another time, take the difference between them and divide by the time that's elapsed, and define that to be the velocity, or if we want to take the limit that time goes to zero, the instantaneous velocity. Of course, the problem with doing that in quantum mechanics is if I make a measurement at the initial time, it's going to disturb the quantum state. So this is where the idea of making a weak measurement of position at the initial time, followed by a very short time later by a strong measurement of position, and then I just take the average of the difference between these two measurement results, conditioned on the final strong measurement, okay, the one that gives a reliable, repeatable answer, gives the answer x, and then I define that to be the velocity of the particle when it is at position x. Okay, so hopefully that makes sense. An equivalent way to do it is if we think we can just measure velocity in itself, so if I can measure this quantity weakly, then I can just do a weak measurement of the velocity conditioned on measuring the particle a short time later to be at position x. So these give the same answers. So, as I said, then we get the standard Bohmian expression for the velocity. As long as the Hamiltonian is at most quadratic and operators canonically conjugate to that corresponding to x, whatever we've chosen x to be. So obviously this is the case for x corresponding to position, because the canonically conjugate observable to position is momentum, and the Hamiltonians that we have are at most quadratic in momentum. Okay. So that might sound like a bug, but I'd actually argue it's a feature, because it forces us to choose this hidden variable to correspond to position rather than momentum, right? Initially, we could have chosen either or some combination of those, but it forces us to choose that because it's not the case, right, that Hamiltonians are at most quadratic in position. If you think about a Coulomb potential or any other sort of potential, right, it's not quadratic in position. Harmonic oscillators are, but harmonic oscillators is not the whole world. Right? So the typical potentials we have are not quadratic in position, And so this, if we believe that this is a good way to define the Bohmian velocity, this forces us towards choosing the position. Okay, so I want to emphasize, I'm not saying that this actually says that Bohmian trajectories are real, the standard Bohmian trajectories as I've defined, but what I say is it does show that Bohmian mechanics has a natural consistency that other hidden variable theories lack. Okay, so that's my motivation. And the other thing, of course, is that that whole idea with weak and strong measurements is that it made this possible. Okay, it made possible this experiment done in the group of Ephraim Steinberg several years ago now. So again, you've seen this before in this conference. I'm not going to say too much about it, except that, of course, what we're not seeing here is somebody actually verifying Bohmian trajectories, right? Actually following the trajectory of an individual particle. That's not possible. What we're seeing is just an ensemble of trajectories reconstructed from a whole load of experimental data. It's basically patching together local measurements of velocity, using that to propagate the trajectory forward at the new position where the particle would be based on that velocity, measure the velocity again, propagate that forward, etc., and then you end up with this ensemble of trajectories here. So again, this is a two-slit experiment, and you see qualitatively at least that it's got the features we'd expect of interference fringes appearing out here because of trajectories converging or diverging according to the wave. Okay, so that's, So what time do I, where's my check? What time do I finish?
15 minutes.
Sorry?
15 minutes.
No, I think I've got a 45 minute talk.
45, sorry, yes.
And when did we actually start?
No, you're up an hour.
Yes, plus a few minutes.
No, up an hour already included.
No, but we started late. That's okay. I'll work. All right, don't worry. Okay, anyway, so 15 minutes roughly, and I've got through one topic in my talk out of three roughly, so that doesn't sound too bad. All right, we'll just go with that. So second topic, this idea of the double slit which way or Velkovec controversy. So just to remind you, a double-slit experiment, we've already seen pictures, I've already shown you pictures that, of course, in the far field we get this characteristic interference pattern due to, in you know, some sense, the particle going or the wave going through both slits. This interference pattern here, if I think of it in momentum space, so of course I'm actually seeing it on a screen, but if I convert to momentum, according to like how long the particles have been traveling, the interference pattern in momentum space has a periodicity equal to h on d, okay, where d is the slit separation back here. So if I now add a which way measurement device back here at the slits to find out which slit the particle went through, of course the interference pattern is going to disappear, which means that this momentum distribution over here is going to have to change. Okay, it won't have the interference pattern anymore. So the simple argument about how we can explain where that change comes from is that if we make a which way or which path measurement back here to distinguish which of these two slits the particle went through, it has to have an error less than or of order d, the slit separation. And by a hand-wavy Heisenberg measurement disturbance relation, that means that it will change or disturb the momentum of the particle by an amount of order h bar over d, which is just how much disturbance you need to wash out these interference fringes. Okay, so that's the classic argument, and this is the uncontrollable change in momentum, which Heisenberg talked about. So these are a little history of the whole controversy, which I haven't got to. We'll get through halfway through. So the first actual single particle double slit interference experiment was done in 1909. In 1926, Bohr introduced his concept of complementarity, which where he was talking about that the reason you get these interference fringes is because if you don't know which path the particle went, then in the absence of the particle information, then the wave phenomena of interference can be observed. Then Heisenberg came along in 1927 with his famous light microscope paper and the Heisenberg uncertainty principle paper, and talked about what happens if you actually try to find out which slit the particle went through, and then this argument that I just rehearsed about trying to find that out, you have to, for example, scatter a photon off the particle, and if that the wavelength of the photon is going to be small enough so that you can tell which slit the particle went through, it's going to give a momentum kick to the particle, which will wash out the interference fringe. Okay. So Bohr wasn't initially very happy about this because it seemed like a different explanation from complementarity, but they came to terms, and Bohr wrote a paper saying that complementarity is enforced by the uncertainty principle. So everybody was happy. All right. So that's how things stood for a very long time. But in 1991, Scully, Englund, and Valter proposed a which-way measurement, a particular type, which they claimed had no momentum disturbance, delta P equals zero. Okay. But of course, it did still destroy the interference. Okay, if you know which path, which slit the particle went through, you can't have interference. So they argued that, in fact, complementarity is not enforced by the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It's a more fundamental principle in itself. But then a few years later, Story, Tan, Collard, and Walls replied to this paper, and they proved a theorem that in any which-way measurement device, there is some momentum disturbance greater than h bar over d. So hopefully you can see the controversy at last, right? Now we have two obviously conflicting claims. And so they concluded that, yes, in fact, the Heisenberg uncertainty principle does enforce complementarity. All right, so what do we do? I happened to be at the time in the group of Dan Walls, where this paper came from, and I and another postdoc there, Fiona Harrison, pointed out that the reason that there were these diametrically opposed claims coming out from these two groups is that delta P in itself doesn't have any unique definition. Okay, and the two groups were using different ideas, they had different intuitions based around their claims about what delta P was. So in particular, Scully, Englund, and Valter were using a sort of a classical intuition, so similar to what Heisenberg was talking about in his paper of momentum kicks, and they rightly deduced that there was no momentum change in that form of classical momentum kicks, whereas Story, Tan, Collard, and Walls were using a formalism of purely quantum formalism. So when they were talking about momentum change, they were talking about having an amplitude for a certain momentum change to occur. Okay. Now, that wasn't the end of the story. From 1995 onwards, there have been quite a lot of experimental and theoretical work on this, which I don't have time to review, because what I want to get on to is the particular topic of today, which is the approach based on Bohmian mechanics. Okay, so more history then. So this is the putting these things together. So in 1998, I showed that in Bohmian mechanics, if we define the momentum to be mass times the velocity, okay, the velocity field being as I defined it before, then we can work out a probability distribution for momentum change or momentum disturbance. And it has the interesting feature that it reflects both Scully, Englund, and Valter and Story, Tan, Collard, and Walls. Okay, and I'll explain this in more detail as we go along. So that's one milestone along the way. The other one, which I've already talked about in 2007, I proposed this way to actually experimentally measure these Bohmian trajectories, or at least experimentally reconstruct these Bohmian trajectories. And then this experiment, which was done in 2011, which I've already talked about. So this was an experiment done with photons, and you might object that photons, of course, are not non-relativistic particles. But the experiment is really talking about the transverse motion of the particles, and in the paraxial approximation, they behave exactly like non-relativistic particles with a mass given, in fact, by their energy divided by the speed of light squared. So it all comes out very nicely, and we can apply it. So in the paraxial approximation, you get a Schrodinger equation for the field in the transverse direction, and the whole theory works out fine. So I'm not going to go through that experiment, but it's very similar to the one I'll talk about later. I just thought I'd flash that up. But what we're really getting to is this 2018 result, which I'm presenting here, which is to measure the Bohmian probability distribution for momentum disturbance as a function of time, which has been measured now for the first time. Okay, so yeah, so 20 years after we proposed. So, okay, so I'm going to go through a bit more theory then of, so back in what I did in 1998 about that. So here's another picture of Bohmian trajectories in a which way measurement. Also, well, I guess not in a which way measurement. This time it's just the interference pattern. So just to emphasize that the Bohmian trajectories in a double slit experiment are not straight, okay? So even though this is free particle propagation, because of the guiding by the wave function, the trajectories move, and so the momentum keeps changing until you get to the far field, okay? So once you're in the far field, then the momentum remains constant, and yeah, we can talk about that infinite time limit. Okay, so if I put a weak wave measurement into this apparatus, so the obvious thing it's going to do is to entangle, say if I have a left slit and a right slit, I just want to know which one it is. I just need a binary which way measurement device, and I could say that after it's interacted here, so that I have the which way information, I've created a state which is a superposition like this. So the particle going through the left slit and the device in the state 0 plus this particle in the right slit and the device in state 1. So if I read this out immediately, the which way information, then of course effectively I'm just finding out whether the particle is in this slit or that slit, and then I get very different trajectories coming out. So can people see the dotted trajectories here? Good, okay, I'm glad I was writing them up. So if I find that it's in the left slit, then I get no interference-like behavior, so none of this finally wiggling. Okay, I just get this diffraction so that they move, and then they're just going after an initial period, they're just going in straight lines, okay? So, and obviously this is for the right slit. Now, so in this case, if you think about, so what is the scale of the momentum change, the momentum disturbance in this case, it's actually huge, okay? Because a particle which in this case ended up with effectively zero velocity, so of course the trajectories don't cross in this approximation at all, which is treated as a 1D problem. So this particle here, for example, ends up with zero momentum, whereas if I did a which way measurement and found that I was over here, then that particle ends up going over here, which is at the limit of the diffraction limit, okay? So the change in the momentum for some trajectories is of order, not h bar over d, the slit separation, but h bar over the slit width, okay, which is a much bigger momentum change. So in other words, the momentum change here is much bigger than you'd expect from the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So that seems a little puzzling, but I don't know, resolution is maybe the wrong word to say, but there is a way to see that there's a momentum disturbance which is much smaller than that, but still non-zero. And the way to do that is, instead of just reading out the which way measurement device in the basis which contains the information, measure it in a complementary basis so that you, in fact, don't get any which way measurement information at all. Okay, so measure it in this plus and minus basis that's defined as a superposition of 0 plus or minus 1. So what that does is it doesn't tell you which slit the particle was in. It actually creates just a new superposition, either with the original phase of 0 or now with the phase of pi between the left slit and the right slit. And so this idea of making a measurement in a basis which doesn't contain any which way measurement information was actually introduced by Scully and Drill in 1982 and called a quantum eraser measurement. Okay, and so this is what we're going to be considering, because in this case, what you find is that the trajectories are much more similar to the original no which way measurement case. So in fact, in one case, right, if I get the result corresponding to the plus result, okay, then in fact that I've created the superposition which is exactly the same as what I had before making the measurement. So the trajectories here, the solar trajectories are exactly the same as up here. And if I get the other result, though, I get quite different trajectories, but they're still showing interference. So now we're getting, instead of getting interference maximum in the middle, I have a minimum in the middle and the first maximum here, etc. Okay, so I get different sorts of trajectories. So in this case, it turns out that the maximum change in the momentum for any trajectory is of order h bar over d. Okay, as you'd expect from the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So in fact, the maximum is actually about 1.48 h bar over d, as we can see from this plot here of the probability distribution for the momentum transfer. So there's a delta function in the middle, and then these wings with a hard cutoff at approximately 1.48. Okay, so you might be wondering what exactly is this thing which I'm plotting here and making these claims about. So it's defined this way, all right? So at any time t, I can talk about the change in the Bohmian momentum by considering what, so starting with a position x naught, say, so at the initial time and a position x naught, I can work out what is the momentum of that particle, the Bohmian momentum of that particle at time t, just by tracing its trajectory forward, okay? Then I can work out what is the momentum of the particle given that I made a measurement and got a result r, okay? Because that effectively changes the wave function, and so I get a change in the momentum going forward as a consequence of that. And then I can say, right, so this delta function here is asking just what is the delta p, which turns this one into that one, okay? So that's the delta p for a particular initial position and for a particular result. Then I want to add, I want to sum over all the possible results with the correct probability given the initial state and the initial Bohmian position, whatever that might be. And of course, I don't know what that is, so I have to integrate over all the possible initial positions weighted according to the equivariant of the quantum mechanical distribution for those things. Okay. So, so that's how I calculated that thing I showed on the previous slide. So in this particular case, this experiment which we've been considering, the one where you just have this simple superposition or simple entangled state like that, it turns out that if I work out the Bohmian momentum distribution at short time, so immediately after the which way measurement has been done, I find that there is no disturbance at all. Okay, so this comes out to be a delta function as a function of delta p. So in other words, delta p is just zero. So initially, just after the which way measurement has been performed, there is no momentum disturbance. Okay, and so this, we'd say this is the non-classical effect. This is what Scully, Englert, and Valter correctly identified as being something unusual about their scheme. Okay, So the total momentum disturbance in this case only occurs in the limit t goes to infinity in the far field case, and that's where we get this distribution which I talked about here. So when I talk about total, I mean the same as in the far field or t goes to infinity. Okay, so the point about this being non-classical is that's very different from what you would get if you had a classical momentum kick. So something like in the Heisenberg-like microscope, for example, where you're actually bouncing a photon off the particle in order to see it. So we defined what we meant by classical momentum kick back in 1995. For that case, the Bohmian probability, not that we talked about that back in 1995, but what you can show is that the Bohmian probability distribution for momentum transfer for the case of a classical momentum kick is independent of t as long as you're after the which way measurement. So basically, the change in momentum happens immediately when the which way measurement is done, and thereafter nothing more happens in terms of momentum. So this is a picture showing. This is again the case of just two measurement outcomes, but corresponding to classical momentum kicks, you see that one, they're the same sort of pattern, but now one is just being moved slanting this way and the other one is slanting the other way. So that corresponds to this type of momentum transfer. So this in the limit of very small slip widths, this momentum transfer will also completely destroy the interference pattern. But does it in a completely classical way that is just saying you either got this amount of momentum or that amount of momentum, and it's the same for all particles and it happens immediately. Okay, so that's a different, very different thing. Okay, so that's where we're saying that you do actually learn something by considering how this is different at different times, and that's related to what Scaliger and Balta and Storytown Colin Walls were talking about. Okay, so we can actually prove a theorem about the mean absolute momentum transfer. So I chose back in 1998 this quantity, this way to talk about the width of that, just because it is the most convenient one for proving a theorem. So it's just the absolute deviation of this distribution. And what we can show is that if the which-way measurement completely destroys the interference, on average, of course, right, averaging over the results, then I can bound below this mean absolute momentum change by 2 on pi times h bar over d. Okay, so there's the h bar over d that we expected, and it just so happens that the pre-factor is slightly less than 1 in this case. And in fact, that this amount is achieved by the particular one which I showed you before, the one which corresponds to the plus and minus readout when you just have this nice entangled state between the two slits. So there are those pictures yet again. And one can also show if it's a which-way measurement which doesn't give you complete information, so that after you've made the which-way measurement, there's still some visibility of the fringes remaining, so it's an imperfect one, then there's a lower bound given by this expression here. Okay, so basically it just smoothly goes to 0 as the visibility goes to 1, so in the absence of any which-way measurement information at all. Okay, so that was the theory, and so the experiment now is, as I said, the one done in Hefei, USTC, and so this is how it's done. I mean, it doesn't look much like a two-slit experiment, but actually that's what's happening here. So there are single photons coming in here. They're heralded from a parametric down converter. This is all about just creating the superposition that we want. So this beam displacer moves the two different polarizations to two different points in space, and so this is basically the two slits. So there aren't literally two slits, but we have two beams, so it's essentially the same thing. Okay. So these various halfway plates, blah, 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 right, are all about just producing the particular state that we want, which has no polarization in it anymore. It just has the two slits, so you might be asking, where's the which-way measurement device in here? So essentially, it's using the polarization of the photons, if you like, as the which-way measurement device itself. Okay. So the particular case we want, where we want to use the quantum eraser basis, that's encoding ultimately what we want to do is we're really choosing the in the quantum eraser case, because the result is independent of the probability of the result is independent of the quantum state, I can essentially just dial up the two possible results that I want in this conformation of the particular halfway plates, etc., that I'm using here, and then just propagate those two independently and add them together at the end. So that's essentially what was done here, because we were using the quantum eraser basis. Okay, so all of the the actual interference for propagation forward, the choosing to measure at a particular time, so the measurement is done here with the CCD. So just as in the original Steinberg experiment, rather than actually physically moving where the position of the detector is, it's all done using optics to effectively just choose the image plane. So the detector remains fixed over here, and you just move these around to choose the right image plane. So here's some experimental data, again looking very similar to what had been seen before. So these are the two different, so this is looking at the velocity or momentum in the far field, And for the two cases, for the phi equals zero superposition, the phi equals pi superposition, and you see that the as you'd expect, that the out-of-phase oscillations in these corresponding to the different interference patterns. This is perhaps more, tells you more directly what's going on. So these are two Bohmian trajectories starting at the same point, but reconstructed in the two different cases of a phi equals zero superposition and phi equals pi. And you see in the phi equals zero, they go towards the central maximum, whereas in the phi equals pi, they go out towards the two first maxima on either side. So that shows the change in momentum depending on which of those results you've got. Okay, so this is the really impressive experimental reconstruction in my view, is to actually work out that thing, this mean absolute momentum change, as a function of time or z, the propagation distance in this thing. And so what we're seeing here is it starts off very small, okay? Not zero because of various experimental and reconstruction details, but very small, and you see that over the course of propagation it grows until you get to the far field and then it remains more or less constant. And this is all in units of h bar over d, so then this is exactly seeing a momentum transfer of order, what you'd expect from the Heisenberg uncertainty principle arguments. So this is a reconstruction. So these were calculated from the probability distributions, which we reconstructed from the trajectories. And so what you were seeing here is this is a far field. The phi equals zero and the phi equals pi case. So you see this is like the delta function, except it's been smoothed a bit. And with peaks out here, just as we saw in the theory, whereas in the near field, you see that there's almost no momentum change. I mean, I think the part of the problem is that this near field was not quite near enough. Ideally, you would want to go back a bit further. But anyway, you see that essentially you've got no momentum change at an early time. They're both just close to delta functions. And then finally, the experimentalists also check this prediction of the size of this mean absolute momentum change as a function of this visibility by just varying the weights given to these two outcomes, and found that it does indeed follow the straight line of the theory. So the red line is the theoretical line, so you see it's quite close to that. The dashed line is a theoretical prediction for the experiment, taking into account some of the imperfections in the experiment. So you see that, I guess what this shows is that we understand the experiment very well, and it's also that it's not really, the imperfections are not too bad because we're not at all far from the theoretical bound. Okay, so to conclude, so this is a summary. So since 1994, there's been this debate about the role of momentum transfer in the which-way measurement device. So Scully et al., SEW, came up with the which measurement for which they claimed there was no momentum change, whereas Story, Tan, Collard, and Walls proved a theorem saying that there always has to be momentum change of order h bar over d. So the reason that it's possible for two groups of intelligent physicists to make completely opposing claims is that they're not being careful enough about their definitions, okay? The problem that momentum disturbance is not a well-defined thing in orthodox quantum mechanics, right? It's only unambiguous if the initial state is a momentum eigenstate, which is obviously not the case for a two-slit experiment, or if we're actually talking just about classical momentum kicks, then there can be no disagreement. But in the case of a two-slit experiment with arbitrary measurements, that doesn't apply, and so we can get this disagreement. So the SEW's claim, really what they meant was that there's no classical momentum kicks. And Story, Tan, Collard, and Walls, their theorem was more general, but it had the odd feature that it actually was not related in any way to the initial state of the two-slit experiment. Okay, so there have been a lot of work on that, and then in fact there's been experimental work, which I haven't talked about previously, which have looked at this in different ways, but I would say that they haven't looked at it fully quantitatively, as opposed to the experiment which I've shown here, where we actually measured a probability distribution for the momentum transfer in the Bohmian theory, and using a which-way measurement, which is basically equivalent to that SEW proposed. And what we find is that we can see aspects of both of those original opposing claims in the sense that we have negligible immediate or knee field momentum change, okay, just as per Scullion and Valter, saying that there's no momentum change, but we see a far field momentum change of order h bar over d in line with the Storyton-Collin-Wolf theorem. But, okay, I don't want to finish with that. I want to finish with some take-home messages, which are sort of broader, because I know that's all very technical, but maybe these will speak more broadly to the audience. I want to say, a number of points. So one, I think it is a mistake to be dogmatic about quantum fundamentals, okay, because there are many ways to look at a problem, and that is definitely the case with the momentum change. I didn't talk about the many papers over the years which have looked at this in different ways, but they all have their pros and cons, and so I'm not claiming this is the only and or final story, but I want to make that point. Second point, operationalists throw away many ways of thinking and doing. So for example, Bohmian mechanics, which is not operational theory, of course, okay, not operational quantum mechanics, Bohmian mechanics allows one to find change of momentum when orthodox quantum mechanics just says that the problem is undefined. Third, that just because it's not part of orthodox quantum mechanics does not mean it cannot be experimentally accessed, and that's what we've learned with weak measurements and all these wonderful things, that, for example, Bohmian trajectories can be found in an almost theory-free manner, okay, using experiments. And finally, it's worth doing the experiment, okay, because I'm a lazy theorist. When I did the work 20 years ago, I only actually calculated this. So this is an example, of course. There are many reasons for doing the experiment, but this is one. I only calculated this change in momentum at the time zero and at time infinity, because those were the times at which it was easy to do. And so I never actually saw this transition from the near field to the far field, this lovely smooth transition, until the experimentalist measured it and plotted it. So I was very happy with that. All right. Thank you very much.
We have time for questions. Lorenzo?
I'm wondering, what if you measure at the end the which way detector? You're not.
Are you talking about a delayed measurement?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
How does the trajectories look like? I mean, it depends on what kind of basis you're measuring in, right?
Then you're talking about reconstructing Bohmian trajectories for a state which is mixed, effectively. And then what you will get from the experiment is not going to agree with what the theory says. So essentially in Bohmian mechanics, so this was sort of what we addressed in the paper from 2 years ago in Ephraim's group. So in Bohmian mechanics, really everything is supposed to be conditioned on the positions of particles, and you know, so everything is effectively in a pure state when you're talking about a single particle is conditioned on the position of the other particles in the universe. Of course, we don't have access to those other particles in the universe. So the only way we can really enforce that to be so is that if you have entanglement, you resolve it straight away by measuring the other system with a macroscopic measurement device, and then the position of that macroscopic measurement device tells you the relevant thing to tell you what pure state you have in the first particle. So the short answer is that you will get, the theory says that's not a situation where you would expect to be able to reconstruct Bohmian trajectories
right.
by this method.
Okay.
But there's many things one could say, but that's just, that's one answer.
Also, oh, what is the particle, actually? It doesn't exist, right?
I think I'll take another question.
Bohmian theory. Oh, sorry. You have two parts to the talk. One in which you discuss the preferential position coordinate with respect to momentum, and the second in which you discussed Welcher-Weig experiments.
Mm-hmm.
My comment is only about the first part. It is not necessary to choose between X and P. It is possible to write down a phase space density, which is of the form modulus square of psi x times delta function, this is an example, times delta function of p minus some function of x. This function of x was gradient of the phase in the Bohm theory.
Okay, but that's exactly what the theory, that is completely equivalent to what I presented, because we're saying that the momentum, yeah, so I guess there was, it only came up halfway through, but I'm saying if we identify the momentum with the mass times the velocity, then that's exactly what we're doing. But we start with the position as the fundamental hidden variable, and then the momentum is just defined in terms of that position, and then that's exactly how these calculations were done.
Okay, yeah. So what I want to say is that it is possible to write down a phase space density with one marginal reproducing the position probability density, and the other marginal reproducing the momentum probability density of quantum mechanics exactly. Whereas in the usual Bohm theory, as was pointed out very early by a Japanese physicist, the momentum probability density is not reproduced, only the position probability density. So it is, you can say that quantum mechanics is context dependent, etc. But what the phase space density construction, which reproduces both X and P, shows that in one context, at least both X and P could have the same status. Of course, it doesn't do away completely with context dependence, because X cosine alpha plus P sine alpha, where alpha is arbitrary, is not reproduced.
Okay, I'll be interested to talk to you later to find out about the distribution.
So I'm going to take the operationalist point of view. So maybe there are several ways of asking this question. Can you do more general, quantum mechanics talks not about interference of trajectories, but real interference of alternatives? And so if I wanted to extend this to Hanbury-Brown and Twiss type interference, or its fermionic analog, could I do that?
Well, I'm not sure what the question you'd be trying to address.
Can I first of all construct an explanation or an interpretation of that type of interference within this framework? And then, of course, within those classes of experiments, also one can come up with which way type questions, and so we, would there be an entire program to extend this?
I do want to emphasize my first point as well, that I'm not being a dogmatic and saying that, the orthodox way of thinking about things is a bad way of thinking about things. For many questions you might want to ask, it's going to be far easier and give you everything that you want to know. So I'm not anti the orthodox interpretation. I'm just advocating being broad-minded and being willing to think about many ways of approaching a problem.
No, but in science we are supposed to ask hard questions, and the hard question here is whether this approach allows you to do things. Or does it actually run into problems if you try and extend it to things that dogmatic
can do? There's been an awful lot of work about Bohmian mechanics and generalization of Bohmian mechanics in quantum mechanics, quantum field theory in general. Of course, I didn't talk about that because it's not relevant to this talk. But it's not as if it's naive and it's only been used for non-relativistic particles.
Well,
for example,
what about the Heisenberg twist? The Hanbury-Brown and twist experiment.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, time
maybe
to.
Maybe
yeah.
We have to go on with.
All right.
The
next
talk. Just short.
Last short comment.
Just to add to what Anupam was asking, in fact, there has been work along like generalizing Bohmian model for the relativistic context, photons, and even talking about Hanbury-Brown twist in books like Peter Holland and so on. And of course, you are right. there's some more extension of that program required. And just one short comment, because I'm tempted, and maybe we talk later when we meet. Just that when you start in the Bohmian model with preferential status for position, there is also a statement made that it is the measurement. The observed position is the same as the measured position, and the observation changes the momentum. So the important feature in your work, as I see it, is you start from the spatial status of position and then relate observed momentum to that positions in a way, the way you define P equal to MV and construct from the Bohmian, what you construct the Bohmian velocity distribution.
Yes, that's true. But I guess what I'd say is that you could attempt to do it the other way around and make momentum your starting point. But you would run into difficulties that this weak definition would not give you. It would be empirically falsifiable, basically. Yeah. Whereas with position, it all works through.
But then you relate the Bohmian velocity distribution to observed velocity distribution that way.
Yes.
Okay.
No,
okay. That is the crucial thing.
Sure.
Yeah.
So okay. Oh, what do they use? I don't know. It's in the paper.
Okay. I will look.
Yeah.
Okay, let's.
But yeah, I should say the paper isn't on. The paper should be on the archive later this week, hopefully. Yes. So you can all check then. All right.
Time to speak.